About 2 years ago, I made a beginner's guide with tips for new Guild Wars 2 players. And although I think it's a bit lame to make another video about a successful topic, I still have some obvious and less obvious tips that I have not yet covered. So in this video, I want to cover some beginner and intermediate tips for you. And if you're totally new, you might want to check out my older video as well. It has plenty of tips for you and you can check it out in the info charts. Even if you play Guild Wars 2 for a while now, there might be something in here that you did not know yet. Before we head into the video, I gotta ask the usual to please YouTube a little bit. Make sure to subscribe, like, leave a comment, and watch this video all the way to the end. And if you think this video is very helpful to a guildie, make sure to share it with them. Let's start this video up with a less obvious tip. Dodge jumping. If you are familiar with the Super Adventure Box that comes around every April Fool's in Guild Wars 2, you might know this tip. Dodge jumping is a technique that gives you some more distance when you are dodging. Why is this useful? Well, for starters, jumping puzzles, areas where you cannot use mounts. This gives you just that extra bit of distance to make it across, whereas normally you would have to perfectly aim and jump to make it. Also, it is useful when you are in a dire situation and you just need that extra distance to get out of it. Now, how do you dodge jump? It's a combination of using your dodge key and your jump key. For me, they are still set to default, V to dodge and spacebar to jump. I can also dodge by double tapping W, A, S or D, but that doesn't work for dodge jumping. You want to use the jump key, spacebar, a little earlier than the dodge key, which is V. This can be a little bit tricky at first, but you will eventually pull it off. Just have a look at how I do it. I actually use my left thumb to press the jump and the dodge key both at the same time. This usually works very well for me and I don't really have to think about dodge jumping anymore. I can just do it on command now. Make sure to practice this while you are out of combat and preferably with the vigor buff. This makes sure your endurance regenerates faster and you can dodge more often. Alright, that's dodge jumping. Let me know in the comments if you need any help with it and if it helped you. Let's move on to tip number 2, which is wiki commands. For some, this might be the most obvious thing ever, but ever since I saw someone not knowing about this feature in the map chat of Lion's Arch, I decided to include it in this list. As you might know, Guild Wars 2 has a huge wiki that is, for the most part, created by players. People like you and me. It is smart to keep this open in a browser tab if you are new to the game. But did you know you can access the wiki from the game itself? You can easily do this by typing /wiki in the chat and press enter. This will open your browser and direct you to the Guild Wars 2 wiki. You can also use it way more efficiently. For example, you can type /wiki, add a space, and then type the subject you want more information on. Well, Guild Wars 2 also has a number of items that can be quite tricky to type in full. Therefore, you can just link the item in question in chat using the shift-click method. So, if you type /wiki and then shift-click the item you want to know more about, you will directly go to that item's wiki page. This method is extremely useful if you are playing in a fractal or if you are at an open world boss and you quickly want to know more about a specific item that just dropped. Another wiki command that I use a lot is the /wiki-et command. ET stands for event timers. This command takes you directly to a nice overview of the current event timers. Here you can see what world boss or what meta event is going to start soon. Really handy if you want to see what event is up next without opening your browser. We are all too lazy to do that. Anyway, I will leave a wiki page with all the commands in the video description. Make sure to share your favorite chat command in the comments. The event timers for meta events and world bosses make a nice bridge to my next subject. Rest people when they are down. You will probably hear this all the time when you are doing a world boss or a meta event. But why do we need to rest downed people as fast as possible? Well, as you might know or not know, Guild Wars 2 uses a mechanic that's called event scaling or upscaling. Meaning, the more players that are present at a specific world boss or meta event, the more enemies will come at you. Also, the health and damage of bosses will increase whenever there are more players around. This was done so events and bosses would stay challenging no matter how many people were around. So, when your health reaches zero, you will go into down state. If your health expires in down state, you will die and you won't be able to get back up until someone reses you or you use a waypoint. Keep in mind that players that are in down state will take periodic damage and damage from the boss or event. This makes it hard for them to get back up under their own. If you see anyone fighting for their life, it is wise to rest them up as soon as possible. Since they are in down state, you will rest them up rather fast in comparison to when players are dead. If you decide not to rest them, they will eventually die. Players that are dead will still upscale the event and will make it harder for players that are still alive. And well, dead players won't really contribute to the completion of the event or world boss. The best thing you can do as a dead player is to use the nearest waypoint, run back and start helping the rest of the players again. In most cases, players won't res you because reviving dead players while in combat takes a significant amount of time. You won't be able to get all the dead players to use the nearest waypoint, but it is nice if they would do so. Just use the most common method, spam the general or say chat and tell them politely to use the nearest waypoint. In short, if you are doing a world boss or a meta event, make sure to res up downed players. And if you are dead, make sure to use the nearest waypoint to help the players that are still participating in the event. Eventually, people that have been dead for a while will not upscale the event or boss. But well, if you died and decide to lay there for about 5 to 10 minutes, well, you are making it hard for your fellow Guild Wars 2 players. Let's move on to the second to last tip in this video, and that is do your dailies. You can probably find this in every other beginner video, but I want to give this one a little twist. It is somewhat of an intermediate tip for people that have already discovered the world a little bit and have tried PvP before. But did you know you can benefit from your dailies in three ways? For you beginners out there, it is important to do your dailies if possible. Usually these won't take long. Depending on the dailies of that day, it should take about 15 to 30 minutes. You can find your current set of dailies by pressing H on your keyboard, navigate to your achievement panel, and press daily. Doing these dailies will grant you 10 achievement points, which are used to show your prestige and give you access to unique armor and weapon skins. And next to that, you will also get 2 gold for completing your dailies. A nice amount of gold if you have recently started playing Guild Wars 2. So you benefit from the gold and the 10 achievement points. I want to add an extra layer to that. This is how I do my dailies. You want to have some experience with PvP before trying out this one. Look for a class you feel comfortable playing with and queue up for a ranked or unranked PvP game. When you win that PvP game, you will be able to complete the 3 PvP dailies for that day and be granted the daily reward chest, gold and achievements. And next to that, you will also gain progress towards PvP achievements. And if you queued up for a ranked match, you will also gain points towards your next division. This way, you can benefit from your daily in multiple ways. If you did not win that one game of PvP, it is most time efficient to look for your daily gatherer or daily vista viewer. These can be done in a minute or less if you have the correct waypoints unlocked. Because you need PvP experience and some waypoints for that specific location unlocked, I'd say this is more a tip for players that have been playing for a few weeks. An intermediate player tip, I'd say. If you want to know more about PvP achievements and daily achievements, I'd suggest you watch my achievement point farming guide. Now, the last tip in this video is completing the map. I have probably mentioned this in some other video, but not very explicitly as a single tip. Why do we want to complete the map? Well, for the exclusive rewards. For completing a non-city map, you can get 2 pieces of equipment, crafting materials, and a transmutation charge or a Black Lion key. The 2 pieces of equipment are scaled to the level requirements for that specific zone. For example, if you complete a level 25 to 35 map, the armor will scale to those levels accordingly. Personally, I don't think that this is the most interesting part of completing a map. It's nice and all, but you want to go for the crafting materials and the transmutation charge. Tier 2 to tier 4 crafting materials, which are, for example, crotton scraps, are usually obtained in level 40 to 60 areas. Since most people can easily get higher level crafting materials like mithril by just playing the game at level 80, these lower level crafting materials are usually worth more on a trading post. Max level players actually have to put in effort to get tier 2 or tier 4 materials, therefore they are worth more. And you can just get them from completing a map. You can sell your newly acquired crafting materials on the trading post or keep them for your own crafting purposes. Also, it is possible to get a transmutation charge from completing a map. These are used to transmog your armor to another piece of armor to your liking. Transmutation charges can be challenging to get, so the chance to get one by completing the map is always nice. If you ever want to craft a first generation legendary, these were the first set of legendaries, for example Sunrise or Bolt, you want to complete all core Tyria maps. This will grant you the gift of exploration, which is used to craft these unique weapons. So if you ever plan to craft these weapons, make sure to start exploring as soon as possible. If you want more tips, I'd suggest to check out my other beginner tips video, which I mentioned at the start of this video. and check out the tips page on the wiki. I will link this page in the video description. Whatever the case, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you still have any questions, make sure to leave them in the comments and make sure to share and subscribe to this channel to help it grow. For now, I would like to thank you all so much for watching, and I hope to see you all in the next one. Peace!